spring rush. It's an invasive plant that occurs in numerous areas in the U.S. Pacific Northwest, particularly, we have some issues in Idaho, Montana, and Washington.
Flowering rush is an aquatic invasive plant. It's actually native range is in Europe, where it's actually an endangered species.
It's been expanding throughout the Columbia River Basin. There's a large population of Flathead Lake in Montana, and it's been slowly working down the Clark Fork and the Ponderay Rivers. We're finding it down to 15, 16 foot deep, there's no really other aquatic plant in the river system that's occupying that niche space.
So it's getting established in a zone that there really aren't a lot of native aquatic plants, and then growing in, as you can see from this behind me, growing in towards shore, so it actually outcompetes and then creates more predator fish habitat.
So it forces those fish to utilize something else, and this particular type of habitat with the invasive plants really invites non-native predator fishes like smallmouth bass, which we have an abundance of here in the system. It's a species that reproduces by rhizome. If this rhizome were to break off like this and float away, wherever this would land, it would resprout, and then, so it sprouts this way, breaks off, floats away, sprouts again.
Somebody leaves with some of these rhizomes on their boat somehow, and they happen to go all the way back to Omaha, or they go back to New Mexico, it falls off. Flowering rush can grow there, so that's key in us stopping it here, so it doesn't get to all the other districts across the nation.
Trying to get more information about the water exchange in some of these areas where flowering rush has become established so we can use aquatic herbicides to potentially control the plant. Last year, as part of this project, we came out and did some initial tests using the rhodamine dye. We had put it out and then take our readings and get a measurements and determine the half-life of how long the dye stays in the system. Then we had come back in with the bubble curtain running and do the same process to see if it extended the time the dye held in the plot. And what that essentially is a hollow tube with a bunch of small holes through it, and we're running air through there, so it creates a wall of bubbles.
And the idea is the airflow from a bubble line disrupts the river flow and contains the treatment, essentially. And so we were using a rhodamine dye, which is a non-toxic red tracer dye used for hydrology studies, run the bubble curtain encompassing the treatment area to see how well we actually retain that dye, which would be equivalent to an herbicide.
We outlined it with the bubble tubing this year, did 5 different dye studies. After treatment, we'll come back about 4 weeks and do a 4-week post-treatment assessment to see what percent control we achieved, look at the impacts to any native species that are in the plot, and determine how well our control efforts were received.
If we work out all the bugs on something like this, then we can actually have a shot at maintaining the spread of a plant like this that really does a lot of harm overall to salmon and steelhead rearing habitat.
With a lighter version, which this company came up with over this past winter, we can go in and treat a small area, put this bubble curtain around, and now we're getting it before it even gets to this.
We actually deployed the bubble light when we were doing our dye studies, and we ran it just along the outside edge of this bulrush, which is a very desired native species to the Columbia River system, to see if we could use the bubble light along the shoreline to prevent any herbicide from moving in, so we decrease the chances of getting any non-target impacts.
This now makes it where instead of you closing off a cove, you're closing off an area that's, maybe the size of your kitchen or something in your house.
The ability to maybe get ahead of something like this before you end up seeing this kind of a plot everywhere, This is really exciting.
If this works and all this comes together, everybody in the U.S. can work. Anybody in the world can use it, technically. Any new invasive that comes in, they want to eradicate it right away. So less chemical, less cost, less time, and you get it right in the beginning. So you're dealing with half an acre versus 20 acres or 10 acres. So this is something that could just really change the whole game in how we deal with aquatics.